Penguin Random House Audio presents Madame Bovary by Gustave Flaubert, translated by Mildred Mahmer, with an introduction by Robin Morgan, read for you by Claire Bloom.
We were studying when the headmaster came in, followed by a new boy not yet wearing a school uniform and a monitor carrying a big desk. Those of us who had been sleeping woke up, and we all stood up as if we had been interrupted in our work. The headmaster motioned to us to sit down again, then, turning toward the teacher, he said, "Monsieur Roger, here is a student I'm placing in your charge. He's starting in the fifth. If he does well, he will advance into the upper school where he belongs at his age." Keeping himself in the corner behind the door so that you could hardly see him, the new arrival was a country boy, about 15 years old and taller than any of us. His hair was cut straight across his forehead like a village choir boy's. He looked sensible and very shy. He sat down, holding his cap on his knees. It was one of those hybrid hats in which you could find elements of a busby, a lancer cap, a bowler, an otterskin cap, and a nightcap. One of those poor concoctions whose mute ugliness contains depths of expression like the face of an imbecile. "Stand up," said the teacher. He stood up. The cap fell. The entire class began to laugh. He stooped down and picked it up. His neighbor made it fall again by poking it with his elbow. He picked it up a second time. "Get rid of your helmet," said the teacher, who was a witty man. There was a burst of laughter from the students. It rattled the poor boy so much that he didn't know if he should keep the cap in his hand, leave it on the floor, or put it on his head. He sat down and placed it on his lap. "Stand up," said the teacher, "and tell me your name." The new boy stammered some unintelligible name. "Once more," said the teacher. The same garbled syllables were heard, drowned by hoots from the class. "Louder," shouted the teacher. "Louder." The new boy, now mustering up all his courage, opened an abnormally large mouth, and, as if he were calling someone, shouted at the top of his voice the word, "Chat Bovary." Pandemonium broke loose. They shouted, howled, stamped their feet, and kept repeating, "Chat Bovary, Chat Bovary." By dint of a shower of threats, order was slowly restored in class. The teacher, who managed to grasp the name of Charles Bovary by having it dictated, spelled out, and read over, immediately ordered the poor devil to sit in the dunce chair at the foot of the lecture desk. "New boy, you will write out 20 times the verb ridiculous sum." None of us now can remember anything about him. He was a mild-tempered boy who played during recess and worked in study periods, listened in class, slept soundly in the dormitory, and ate heartily in the dining hall. He managed to stay in the middle of his class by working very hard. Once he even won an honourable mention in natural history. But at the end of his third year, his parents took him out of school to study medicine, convinced that he could win his school degree by studying on his own. The courses that were listed on the bulletin board terrified him. Anatomy, pathology, physiology, pharmacy, chemistry, botany, clinical medicine and therapy, not to mention hygiene and materia medica, all names that loomed like majestic shadows in temple doors. He understood nothing. No matter how hard he listened, he just couldn't grasp the subject. Yet he worked hard, he acquired bound notebooks, went to all his lectures, didn't miss one single class. He managed his daily assignment of work like a mill horse who trots around in blinders, unaware of what he is grinding. He prepared unceasingly for his examination. He memorized all the questions beforehand and passed with a decent grade. It was a happy day for his mother. They celebrated with a big party. Where would he practice? In Tote. There was only one old doctor there. Madame Bovary had been watching out for his death for a long time, and the good soul had barely expired when Charles moved in across the street as his successor. But it was not enough to have raised her son, arranged for him to study medicine, and discovered Tote for him to practice in. He needed a wife. She found him one, Madame Dubuc, the widow of a Dieppe bailiff who was 45 years old and had an income of £1,200. Charles had hoped for better days following his marriage. He assumed he would be freer to choose his own actions and spend his money as he pleased. But his wife was the ruler. He had to watch what he said and didn't say in public, eat fish on Friday, dress as she prescribed, and harass the patients who didn't pay. She would open his letters, spy on his whereabouts, and listen behind the partition when there were women in the consulting room. And she would end by asking him for some medicine for her health and a bit more love. About 4 o'clock one morning, they were awakened by the sound of a horse stopping right at their door. The messenger handed over a letter sealed with a dab of blue wax, which begged Monsieur Bovary to come immediately to Les Bertaux to set a broken leg. It was an impressive farm. In the stables over the open doors, big workhorses could be seen feeding leisurely at their new mangers. A large dunghill extended along the length of the buildings. Among the hens and turkeys, 5 or 6 peacocks were foraging on top. The sheepfold was long, the barn high, with walls as smooth as a woman's hand. The yard, its trees planted equidistant from one another, sloped upward, and the gay cackle of a flock of geese came from the pond. A young woman in a blue wool dress trimmed with 3 flounces came to the threshold to receive Monsieur Bovary. Charles went up to the second floor to see the patient. He found Monsieur Rouault in his bed, perspiring under the covers. He was a short, heavy man of 50, with white skin and blue eyes. He was bald on the forepart of his head and wore earrings. It was an extremely simple fracture, with no complications whatsoever. Charles couldn't have wished for an easier one. The bandages in place, the doctor was invited by Monsieur Rouault himself to have a bite with his daughter, Mademoiselle Emma, before leaving. At first they discussed the patient, then the weather, the cold spells, the wolves roaming the fields at night. Mademoiselle Rouault didn't like the country at all, especially now that she was almost solely responsible for the care of the farm. Charles was surprised at the whiteness of her nails. They gleamed cleaner than Dieppe ivories and were almond-shaped. Her hand was not attractive, however, perhaps not white enough. Her real beauty was in her eyes. Although they were brown, they seemed black because of the lashes, and she would look at you frankly, with bold candour. Instead of returning to Les Bertaux 3 days later, as he had promised, he appeared the very next day, then regularly twice a week, not counting the unscheduled visits that he paid from time to time, as if by accident. Everything was going well, the injury was healing properly, and when at the end of 46 days old Rouault was seen trying to walk by himself, people began considering Monsieur Bovary a very talented man. Old Rouault said that he wouldn't have been treated better by the most prominent doctors of Yvetot or even of Rouen. During the first weeks that Charles frequented Les Bertaux, his wife did not fail to keep herself informed about the patient. She had even chosen a lovely white page for Monsieur Rouault in the double-entry account book. But when she heard that he had a daughter, she sought information. She learned that Mademoiselle Rouault, brought up in a convent of the Ursuline order, had received, as they say, a good education. As a result, she knew dancing, geography, drawing, tapestry weaving, and piano playing. It was just too much. So that's the reason he looks so radiant when he goes to see her, she told herself. That's why he puts on his new waistcoat at the risk of spoiling it in the rain. Oh, that woman, that woman. And she hated her instinctively. At first she contented herself with allusions. Charles didn't understand them. Then by casual comments that he let pass for fear of a storm. Finally, by point-blank insults to which he did not know how to reply. Charles stopped going to Les Bertaux. So he obeyed, but the boldness of his desire protested against the civility of his conduct, and with a sort of naive hypocrisy, he concluded that his being forbidden.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.